Well, friends, let's move on now in this session to think about, we looked at how justification by faith alone forges mission. I want to think now about that other principle, Scripture alone, and how Scripture alone, or sola scriptura, fertilizes mission. Now, can I just be very clear what I'm saying here? I don't want to look at why Scripture is important. I don't want to look at why a merely high view of the Bible is important, because both of those things were affirmed by Roman Catholicism, a high view of the Bible and that Scripture is important. That was not what distinguished the Reformers from the Roman Catholic Church. The Reformers were saying something more than we have a very high view of the Bible or that Scripture is important. They were saying sola scriptura. So let me just define that so we can be clear. Now, when Luther began his protest, he was addressing a church in Rome that affirmed Scripture's authority and inspiration. So what was different about Luther's position? Luther said Scripture alone is the inerrant supreme authority. So popes and councils can err. Scripture does not. Scripture alone does not. And so what distinguished the Reformers from Rome was their claim that, as important as tradition is, and yes, the Reformers thought tradition is important. You don't just jettison what Christians have been thinking through for years without good reason. But tradition is not without error. Only God's word is. And because Scripture is the entirely trustworthy word of God, Scripture alone is the church's ultimate authority sufficient for faith and practice. Now, this was critical in the early debates of the Reformation. So, very quickly after Luther pinned his 95 theses on the Wittenberg Castle Church door, a theologian called Sylvester Prierius was hauled up by the Pope to be the first theologian to take Luther on in debate. Brave man. And Prierius, very quickly, he was a sharp man, he saw very quickly the real issue at stake was the question of authority. Who do we trust? Who's telling you what you should believe, what is true? And Prierius said this. Opposing Luther, he said this: he who does not accept the doctrine of the Church of Rome and the Pontiff of Rome as an infallible rule of faith, listen to this, from which the Holy Scriptures draw their strength and authority, is a heretic. So the Scriptures draw their authority from the Church of Rome and the Pope. The next theologian to take on Luther was Cardinal Cajetan. And he argued, along the same lines, Scripture needs to be, in fact, must be, interpreted by the Pope. For the Pope is above not only church councils, but Scripture itself. The Pope is above Scripture itself. Luther replied with these words: His Holiness the Pope abuses Scripture. I deny that he is above Scripture. And that really summed up much of Luther's early debates in a nutshell. Roman theologians insisted on the infallibility of the papacy, and the more they did it, the more Luther relied on the authority of Scripture. And that difference is still there in the difference between the Roman Catholic and evangelical positions. In the Roman Catholic Catechism of the Catholic Church, it says this: both Scripture and tradition must be accepted and honored with equal sentiments of devotion and reverence. Scripture and tradition, you treat them equally. In contrast, evangelicals hold the Bible is our chief, supreme, ultimate authority. That's the meaning of sola scriptura. Sola scriptura is not the same thing as nuda scriptura, the idea that we have no creed but the Bible. That was not the reformers' position. So sola scriptura acknowledges there are other authorities to which we listen. I listen to wiser, older Christians. I listen to church leaders. I listen to great theologians of the past. But Scripture alone is the authority that rules over and governs all other authorities. I listen with great respect to a mature, wise Christian leader, with great respect. But Scripture is supreme over even what a wiser, older Christian leader says. So all other authorities are to be followed only in as much as they align with Scripture, as long as they submit to Scripture, are subservient to Scripture, which is alone our supreme authority. Scripture alone is supreme. It is not equal to anything. Scripture alone is the sufficient authority. Now, having explained that, sorry, that's a little explanation. Now, why is that relevant for mission? Well, sola scriptura immediately affected the mission of the reformers, spurring them, you could see it very quickly, spurring them to make the Bible available in the languages of the people. Because if scripture is supreme, if you don't need to have scripture filtered through the higher authority of the Roman Church and the Pope, well, then the Bible can and should be read by all. So as soon as you say that scripture is supreme, it should be read by all. It doesn't need a filter. You don't need to have the Pope or a priest who is the one you're really actually listening to. No, scripture can be read by all. And therefore, you just watch what that did 500 years ago. So it was in 1520 that Luther made his Here I Stand speech before the emperor, the Holy Roman Emperor, Charles V. And so that was in 1520. He was declared a heretic. On his way home, he was kidnapped and smuggled to safety in the Wartburg Castle. While he was there, this is 1521 to 1522, there he translated the New Testament in 11 weeks from the Greek. Now, what's worth noting is the dates there. As soon as the Reformation's got going, as soon as he's committed himself, the first moment he gets of some freedom, once he's holed up in this castle, what does he do? Make the New Testament available, because he says, I want the German people to taste the clear, pure word of God. That's what he wants. 3 years later, in 1525, and also in Worms, where Luther had made that stand, William Tyndale produced his New Testament in English. And both Luther and Tyndale, over the years that followed, would go on to produce, translate the Old Testament, or as much of it as they survived to produce. We often tend to stop there in the English-speaking world, but Europe was filled with stories like this. So in the next few years in France, Pierre Robert made the New Testament available in French. He was a cousin of John Calvin's. The Italian reformer Antonio Brucioli made the New Testament available in Italian. The Swedish reformers Lars Andersson and the Persson brothers made the New Testament and the whole Bible very quickly available, well translated into Swedish. Mikhail Agricola did it into Finnish, Sylvester into Hungarian. And so I could go on. In the English-speaking world, we tend to think only of Tyndale. But across Europe, from the period 1520 to 1540, saw a stunning number of Bible translation efforts. all of them seeking to bypass the Roman Church's interpretations and its official Latin text, the Vulgate, and going straight, or as straight as they could, to the Greek and Hebrew sources. Now, note, it is not just a high view of Scripture that sparked all these Bible translations. The Roman Catholic Church also had a high view of Scripture. It was sola scriptura, Scripture as supreme, that meant Bible translation and Bible distribution. That was the spur for it all. And let's be clear, what exactly is it that's motivating all this Bible translation, Bible reading, Bible teaching that happened? It was this. Rome said, the church has produced the word. Remember those theologians saying the church, the Pope, is an authority above Scripture? That was because they said, well, the church wrote Scripture. So the church is an authority over Scripture. The reformers said it's exactly the other way around. The church is the creature created by the word. The church only comes into existence when the word of God goes out. And so the standard Reformation definition of the church was articulated here by John Calvin. I could give you 20 others that say almost identically the same thing. John Calvin said, wherever we see the word of God purely preached and heard, and the sacraments administered according to Christ's institution, there it is not to be doubted a church of God exists. Where is the church? Not where there's a building. Where is the church? Where the word of God is preached. And so, for the reformers, the heart of mission is the word of God going out. Now, that might seem kind of obvious to us. The heart of mission is the word of God going out. But it was absolutely revolutionary and had revolutionary consequences, which are worth bearing in mind. For that meant it doesn't have to be clergy or just the church's theologians who advance the church in the world. All believers can do it. Sola scriptura means mission is for all, because all can take the word out, and mission is the word going out. And more. Mission is the word going out, and here it starts sounding more surprising. All we need is the word going out. Because John Calvin saw sola scriptura, supreme authority of Scripture, means something else as well. There's a consequence to it. If Scripture really is supreme, it must be, as he put it, self-authenticating. It must prove itself to be the Word of God. Now, why does one mean the other? Well, if the scriptures require something else to give them their authority, they're not supreme, right? If I cannot receive the word of God without something else telling me to receive it, Scripture is not supreme. And so it was important. If Scripture is the supreme authority, it must prove itself to be the word of God. It doesn't depend on other authorities to tell you that it is. And so self-authentication was important for the first reformers. It was part of upholding the supremacy of Scripture. Let me just give you a couple of examples of what this then looks like. William Tyndale's disciple, John Rogers, was on trial for his life. And he was being judged by Bishop Stephen Gardiner, And Gardner said this to Rogers: "You can prove nothing by the scripture. The scripture is dead. It must have a living expositor." I wonder what you'd say to that. Rogers replied, "No, the scripture is alive." Well, let me give you a mission example from how the gospel was taken to Korea. The gospel came to Korea through a Welshman. His name was Robert Germain Thomas. Robert Germain Thomas was based in China, heard about this closed, sealed hermit kingdom of Korea, and then did something really foolish. He got on board a US gunboat to sail up the Pyongyang River against a very insular kingdom. Not a wise move to do. It looks extremely hostile. Anyway, he got on board this US gunboat, the USS Sherman, loaded with Bibles that they could read. And what happened is it sailed up the Pyongyang River, and the Koreans firebombed the boat. Everyone jumped overboard and was swimming for the shores, and the accounts tell us that everyone was screaming for mercy, screaming for their lives, except for one man, Robert Germain Thomas, who instead was holding out his Bible for them to take it. They never took it while he was alive. He was beheaded before that could happen. Robert Germain Thomas was beheaded and never saw the fruit of anything. But the man who beheaded him took that Bible and ripped it up, and then took the paper from it and lined the room of his house with it, and then read it and was converted. And there in Pyongyang, what is now North Korea, is the very beginnings of the Korean church, founded not on any living expositor. The Word of God alone did it. The Word of God itself was sufficient. That's what the reformers were talking about. And let me explain a little bit more what's going through the reformers' heads here. What do they mean? Let me read you from Calvin. Calvin says, "Scripture's authority may be established as certain, and to banish all doubt from our minds, Scripture exhibits fully as clear evidence of its own truth as white and black things do of their color, of sweet and bitter things do of their taste." He said, read Demosthenes or Cicero or Plato or Aristotle or others of that tribe, and they will, I admit, allure you, delight you, move you, enrapture you in wonderful measure. What a geek. But take yourself from them to sacred reading, and then, in spite of yourself, so deeply will it affect you, so will it penetrate your heart, so fix itself in your very marrow that, compared with its deep impression, the orators and philosophers will nearly vanish. Consequently, it's easy to see the sacred scriptures, which so far surpass all gifts and graces of human endeavor, they breathe something divine. The scriptures evidence themselves to be what they claim to be. They show themselves, they breathe something divine. They show themselves to be, prove themselves to be, in many different ways, the very Word of God. And that, friends, is vital for healthy mission. Because God's Word by itself and by its nature proves itself to be the Word of God, we can, like Robert Germain Thomas, give people Bibles in their own language, and we can have confidence God's Word can prove itself. And indeed, the fact that God's Word has proved itself to all these different cultures of the world is itself a demonstration of its divine self-authentication. Scripture, accepted by all these different cultures of the world, clearly is not just the product of one culture, appealing only, say, to those in the Middle East. or conforming all cultures to something Middle Eastern. That's not what happens. So scripture does speak through human cultural genres, but it has a supracultural, transcultural message that no human born of one culture could produce. And this is so liberating for mission. It means mission doesn't depend on knowing, say, the apologetic differences of every different culture. Mission doesn't depend on having to have apologetic texts to give out alongside the Bible. Now, hear me right. Having such apologetic material, contextualization and all that, knowing the apologetic issues in a culture are really useful. But they're not indispensable. Scripture proves itself, and therefore mission can happen with Scripture alone. Sola Scriptura liberates mission. You can have a Robert Germain Thomas situation where you just give out the Word of God. And we want to do as much as we can to enable people to understand it right, to distribute it, to make this message clear. But Scripture itself has the power to prove itself. And one thing more. Sola Scriptura guards the gospel purity of our mission. Because when we acknowledge the supreme authority of Scripture, we allow Scripture to test the message that we proclaim. We allow Scripture to judge whether we are adding something that is merely cultural to the biblical message. And that's a hard thing to detect, isn't it? Working across cultures. But Scripture is the judge to test whether we are adding something cultural, taking something away from the message of Scripture. And so Sola Scriptura helps guard us from smuggling cultural or sectarian or party ideas into the gospel. And this was precisely what happened at the Reformation. Recognizing the supreme authority of Scripture allowed the Reformers to hold out a message that would overturn the culturally assumed theology of the day. And that's mission. The advance of the light of the gospel into the darkness of human sin and ignorance. And what I want to very quickly try to do with you now, I want to try to show you three ways Sola Scriptura did that in the Reformation. Very quickly, I want to show you three culturally assumed beliefs that were there in medieval Roman Catholicism, and I'm picking them not only because they were really central in medieval Roman Catholicism, but also they linger today in evangelical circles. So you'll smell something familiar here. Okay? So I'm going to go for three really critical issues that are still around with us today. That Sola Scriptura, because it was judging the theology of the Reformers, it meant that they could have a message that overturned these culturally assumed ideas. First one was challenged, the nature of the human problem. In medieval Roman Catholicism, Aristotle's idea of what's wrong with us and what we need to do reigned supreme. Aristotle said, we become righteous by doing righteous deeds. Isn't that what most people say? You become righteous by doing righteous deeds. It's a sort of fake it till you make it ethics. If you want to become righteous, just do a lot of good stuff and you become a good person. Do good stuff, you become a good person. And the idea then was our problem is basically we are spiritually sluggish and sleepy. You're just a bit lazy. And so what we need if we're to become righteous is to pull ourselves together, put in a bit of effort. Sound familiar? Isn't that what the culture is always saying? to become better in whatever way you want to, you work at it. And you can do it. You've got it in you. Hey, the hero is within and all that. Yeah? Today, instinctively, we buy this. But Luther's own experience had given the lie to that. Because what he'd done was he tried to work at making himself righteous. He'd really tried. He'd you know, confessed his sins for 6 hours straight. He'd gone sleeping in a freezing cell. He'd done everything he possibly could. And his where he was left was, he said, I did not love, I hated God. So all this trying to make himself a good person, a righteous person, was actually leading him to break the first commandment. I hated God, this monster who was making me do all this moral stuff. And so what Luther found is he could achieve an outward appearance of righteousness, but it would be a hollow sham, and it was for him. It was a hollow sham of self-dependence, self-worship, self-righteousness. And what Luther came to see is that the way Scripture sees our problem is the other way round. The problem is not something on the outside that we work to improve. The problem is far deeper. It's on the inside, in my heart. And I don't need a change by tinkering with my behavior. That's not my problem. I need my very heart to be renewed. And if I'm changed from the inside out, then my behavior will change. And he was thinking of, for example, what's the promise of the new covenant? The Lord will give his people new hearts. You must be, John 3, born again. The problem then is not simply, I'm a bit lazy, I need to work at it a bit harder. The problem is far, far deeper in my heart. And I can't fix that by myself. I need to become a new person. I need to be born again. I need to have new desires where I actually love God rather than simply trying to buy him off. And Luther saw, only if you get your problem is so bad that you cannot fix yourself, only then do you throw yourself in dependence on Christ. Otherwise, you're still going to just try to sort yourself out. Only when you despair of yourself are you going to look outside yourself for help. And that's just what you see in the Gospels. It's the one with the great debt cancelled who loves his creditor most. It's the forgiven prostitutes, tax collectors who weep with joy, give away their wealth, love Jesus. It's the Pharisees, those who think they have something in themselves on which to depend, they never find that liberation and transformation. And so you see this deep view of sin, a total corruption of my will, actually enables me, by acknowledging the depth of my problem, to find a liberty in Christ, because I give up on myself. And I look for the solution in Christ and not in myself. A deep view of sin was critical for the Reformation. Second, the solution. So, view of the human problem being merely superficial, merely lazy, to being deep. The fact we need a new heart, a new birth. Second, the solution. What is grace? Medieval theologians like to say, God gives grace to those who do their best. Doesn't that sound great? God gives grace to those who do their best. That's what Luther was taught as a young man. Now, there are a few problems with that, Luther started to see in Scripture. It's not really grace if you're trying your best already. We've already seen this morning, grace for Luther means God in his love loves foolish persons, sinners, weaklings. He doesn't find what's already good. The love of God flows forth and bestows good. But there was another difference. In medieval Roman Catholicism, grace was taken to be a thing. Basically, it was conceived as like a sort of spiritual Red Bull. Your problem is lazy. You can't be bothered to be holy. Take grace, tank it back, and you'll feel energized. You'll feel, all right, I'll go and do holy stuff now. I'm kind of wired. But grace then was a thing that you're given. You go along to church to get this thing, meaning that the treasure of the gospel is a thing. That's what you're after. You go to church because you want to get this thing called grace, and grace will enable you to get this thing called heaven. What's your treasure? What is it you really want? Heaven, not God. And I think this is still around today. I was convicted of this myself. I was reading the theologian Jonathan Edwards, and he said this at one point in one of his works. He said, the hypocrite loves the gifts of God more than God himself. He wants heaven, but not to be with God himself. And when Edwards wrote that, I thought, you've got me. That is exactly what I want. I want the stuff. Give me paradise. Give me life eternal. But I don't really care if God's there or not. I just want happily ever after for me, because I love me. Oh. And the treasure of the gospel then for me, and I think for so many then, is this abstract blessing, paradise, heaven, eternal life. Luther saw in Scripture it's very different. What does God give? What is the gift of God? John 3:16. God so loved the world that he gave his only son, not some stuff. He gave his son. Romans 5:5, which we read this morning. God has poured his love into our hearts through the Holy Spirit, which he has given to us. What is the gift of God? The Father gives the Son and the Spirit to us. God gives himself. What is the treasure of the gospel? God is. Fellowship with God. We're not just waiting for some future age where things will be put right. The treasure of the gospel is knowing him, in part by faith now, fully then. Hence, Paul writes in Philippians, my desire is to depart and be. He doesn't say in heaven. He doesn't say my desire is to depart and be in heaven. He says my desire is to depart and be with Christ. Because for Paul, heaven would not be heaven without Christ. So there was another real difference. What is the treasure of the gospel? What is grace? Roman Catholicism was saying grace is a thing. You're given this abstract blessing. The Reformers were saying in grace, which means God's kindness, God gives himself. He's the treasure of the gospel. Last one. Who's God? We saw a little bit how Luther's view of who God is changed from being one who demands works to one who bestows good. But actually, in medieval Roman Catholicism, theologians have started becoming a little unclear on who God is. So the greatest medieval theologian, Thomas Aquinas, in his main work, the Summa Theologica, he spends a long time showing from reason the things we can say about God. God's simplicity, majesty, authority, immutability, all that stuff. And then, only when he's spoken about God for a very long time, then he briefly mentions the Trinity. And not for long. So he's not very clear on which God he's talking about. I think we've got the same problem today. We can fail to be specific about which God, the identity of God, and that will shape the gospel. If we're merely abstract in our talk about God, if we simply say he's the creator, he's the ruler, the very shape of the gospel can be affected. We think, so then the relationship I have with him is merely I'm a creature. I live before him as my ruler. From that abstract understanding of God, I could never understand, no, the gospel brings me such that he is my Abba, my Father. I've got to be specific that God is Father, Son, and Spirit to appreciate that blessing of the gospel. And this is exactly what the Reformers did. They were very clear. From the earliest days, the importance of being clear on who God is. As early as 1520, Luther said, "The Trinity is the highest article of faith on which all others hang." Who God is determines everything about the nature of the Christian faith. And I want to show you just one example of how richly Trinitarian Reformational faith was. I just want to read you the first question and answer of the Heidelberg Catechism. You may be familiar with this. If you're not, you're going to love this. But what I want you to do is just listen for how Trinitarian this is. Not for the sake of going, oh, clever, we spotted Father, Son, and Spirit. Well done, us. Not that. But what role do Father, Son, and Spirit have in all this? Okay? They're not just inserted in here so that we all go, oh, good, so we're orthodox. They're here for a purpose. So, here's the question and answer. Listen to how Trinitarian this is. What is your only comfort in life and death? What a great question. What is your only comfort in life and death? Answer. That I, with body and soul, both in life and in death, am not my own, but I belong to my faithful Saviour, Jesus Christ, who with his precious blood has fully satisfied for all my sins and redeemed me from the power of the devil. And he so preserves me that without the will of my Father in heaven, not a hair can fall from my head. Yea, that all things must work together for my salvation. Wherefore, by his Holy Spirit, he also assures me of eternal life and makes me heartily willing, ready to live for him. See it? Those words, Christ, Father, Spirit, have not just been chucked in so we all go, oh, well done, that's kosher. No, we see the comfort of the believer is bound up with who God is. It is Trinitarian. Assurance of salvation, the knowledge of God's fatherly, providential care, the Spirit's renewal of believers, the hallmarks of Reformed theology, they receive their rationale from the fact that God is Father, Son, and Spirit. Where Roman Catholicism had been unclear on who God is, the Reformers were very clear, and it meant that there was a sweetness to their gospel because they could know their adoption before the Father, not just their standing before a God, their adoption by the Father, the fact that he, in his fatherly providence, cares for them, and that the Spirit transforms them and keeps them to the uttermost. That was just some of the ways in which Sola Scriptura helped to purify the message that the Reformers went out with. And so all told, Sola Scriptura was key, liberating, and fertilizing, enabling biblical, healthy mission in the Reformation. With the Bible supreme, Christians could advance into the world with both faithfulness and boldness, taking the word out boldly, knowing its power and its authority. In the words of Martin Luther, words which I cling on to as a gospel minister, "And though this world with devils filled should threaten to undo us, we will not fear, for God has willed his truth to triumph through us. The prince of darkness grim, we tremble not for him. His rage we can endure, for lo, his doom is sure. One little word shall fell him." Let's pray. Father, thank you for your word. Thank you for the power and authority of your word. Thank you that that little word can fell the prince of darkness. And we pray for ourselves here now that, acknowledging the supreme authority of Scripture, we might have confidence in it. Let it judge the message we proclaim. And let it foster in us a desire then for all to read the clear, pure word of God and to enjoy it and so come to know you better. And we ask these things for our joy and for the glory of Jesus. Amen.